broadcast is not working, but it's recording.
All right.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وجعل الظلمات والنور ثم الذين كفروا بربهم يعدلون وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله بشر وأنذر لا خير إلا دل الأمة عليه ولا شر إلا حذرها منه فصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهداه إلى يوم الدين نسأل الله جل وعلا أن يبصرنا بالحق وأن يمن علينا بالالتزام به والثبات عليه حتى يتوفانا وهو راض عنا اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا وقلبا خاشعا وعملا متقبلا اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا شقيا ولا محروما اللهم إنا نعوذ بك أن نضل أو نضل أو نزل أو نزل أو نظلم أو نظلم أو نجهل أو يجهل علينا اللهم آمين. All praise is due to Allah Azza wa Jal. We praise Him, we thank Him, we seek His assistance, we seek His tawfiq. We pray to Him to keep us on the straight path, Sirat al-Mustaqim, until we meet Him and He is pleased with us. And we pray to Him to keep giving us the tawfiq, to sit down in these circles of knowledge, and to teach us that which is beneficial to us, and to give us the tawfiq to apply it. فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. I welcome you all brothers and sisters on this night that I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make it blessed night, the night of the 24th of Rabi' al-Awwal of the Hijri year 1438-39, since Hijrat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which also translates into the 24th of December of the Gregorian calendar 2016. And I commend each and every one of you who chose to sit down with us, learn beneficial ilm, because like I said, ya akhwan, wallahi, one of the greatest moments and the most beneficial moments of your life is when you actually learn the beneficial ilm. Not any ilm, not any knowledge, but the beneficial knowledge that helps you and gets you and gives you khair in this life and in the hereafter. Which in other words is the knowledge that makes you more aware of Allah Azza wa Jal, which makes you understand what He wants from you, that leads you and guides you to obedience to Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is what we're trying to do in these circles of ilm on a weekly basis. First, let me get this out of the way. Next Saturday, we'll be off. Because I know I gave this a little bit of thoughts, and I think everybody would like to spend more time with their families and their kids. I, for one, would like to spend some time and have some rest after a long and tough year. So next Saturday, inshallah, we'll be off. We'll resume bi idhnillahi ta'ala the following one, which will be in the new Gregorian year. SubhanAllah, time passes by so quickly. The second thing that I wanted to actually say just before we start with our halaqa is, ya akhwan, yani I see some of you come alone. And by the way, you know, quickly, I don't know what's the relationship between the cold weather and you know, diminishing audience, if you wish, or level of audience, of attendance. I know it's cold. I know the weather is not, you know, it's not easy to come here, but hey, we have cars. I mean, come on, heated cars, all the luxury we want. So it's not like you're walking to here. So I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make everybody realize the importance and get back to the same level of audience that we used to enjoy before. You know, I see some of you come on their own. And I wanted to actually bring your attention to something. Ya akhwan, it is very important to realize that each and every one of us, being the household, being the father or the husband, right? And you know, in their family, that means you have a responsibility here. The rest of the members of your family have rights on you, actually rather obligations on you, to teach them that which is beneficial to them. They are entitled to learn the deen like you are. And they are servants to Allah Azza wa Jal like you are. Right? And they are entitled to learn this. And they deserve, and they are actually, it is an obligation on you to teach them. You're not supposed to just leave them like this, but rather to teach them about Allah Azza wa Jal, to make them aware of Allah Azza wa Jal, your wife, your kids, all of it, even your, you know, the rest of your descendants. They all have an obligation on you. And if they're not able to come for whatever reason, you should bring them. And if not possible, then at least you should make sure that you understand what we say in here, and then go back home and tell them. Right? Tell them what you learned in here. A lot of us, ya akhwan, you know, we get into this busy schedule and we are heedless about that, right? We forget about our families. We think that if we just bring them, you know, good food and, you know, and give them a good life, then we're actually, you know, giving them their rights. Wallahi, believe me, this is the least of their concern on the day after. What should be more important and should be prioritized is actually to teach them and convey to them the knowledge that is necessary to them. And we're all accountable to Allah Azza wa Jal. We are all mukallafin. And we were created for the very purpose of worshiping Allah Azza wa Jal. If they don't worship Allah Azza wa Jal the correct way, if they don't know how to perform wudu the correct way, if they don't know how to offer the salat the correct way, if they don't know how what to believe in Allah Azza wa Jal, that's a big problem. So we shouldn't actually overlook this and make sure that we all are, you know, learn that what we must learn. Not the whole ummah is expected to be scholars, but there is a part of the knowledge that is required, yes, required of every Muslim. No Muslim can afford not to know the tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal. That's the essence of the deen. How can you not know it or understand it, right? How can you afford, for example, not to know the six pillars of Iman? It's inconceivable that a Muslim, to be a Muslim without knowing this mandatory minimum knowledge. So we need to understand that, ya akhwan, make sure that our wives, our kids, our relatives, they all know the minimum knowledge that is required of every Muslim for their Islam to be correct. So that they can actually conduct their life according to what Allah Azza wa Jal wants from us. And guess what? When they do that, Allah Azza wa Jal guarantees to them that they will live a happy life. You can get them all the money you want. And that's not going to make them happy, by the way. It's not going to make them happy. You want your family to be happy? Happiness is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal. And He guarantees it to the one who actually live their life according to what Allah Azza wa Jal wants. That's the happy life. So let us, ya akhwan, remember this. Next time you come, bring your family with you. Alhamdulillah, there is the sister section up there. Alhamdulillah, they're actually getting involved. They sometimes ask questions. And they have the right to hear and listen. And understand this deen. Right? Like the sahabiyat. Aisha, Umm al-Mu'mineen. Right? And Asma bint Abi Bakr. And the rest of the sahabiyat. They played a big role. By the way, Aisha was one of the greatest fuqaha of the ummah at the time. Yes. She narrated a great deal of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How many hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim and the other books of hadith were narrated by the mother of the faithful, Aisha bint Abi Bakr? How many? In the thousands. And she's a woman. So they're no less than the man, right? And they don't have lesser rights or anything. We are on equal footing with respect to the right to learn about Allah Azza wa Jal and learn His deen and even excel in that and become, you know, a alim or a mujtahid, right? They have equal right. And sometimes they do excel in, you know, they outpace the man. With that said, so we started this explanation of Al-Aqeedah al-Tahawi, of this relatively short and concise book, which is called Al-Aqeedah al-Tahawiyya, in relation to the author of this book, who is Imam Abu Jaafar al-Tahawi, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a, a great scholar of Madhab al-Imam Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. And he wrote it to put it in writing, to put the Aqeedah of the Ahl Sunnati wa Jama'a in writing. Like I said, all the scholars have praised it afterward, and they said it is representative of the Aqeedah or Mu'taqad Ahl Sunnati wa Jama'a, and what they need to believe in with respect to Allah Azza wa Jalla. We started, and we said that we started by explaining those statements, and we said that we actually numbered these statements, as you see on the projection. Each statement has a number, and we're going through the book statement by statement and commenting on each one of them, right? So alhamdulillah, the last few weeks we explained the first four statements, I believe, or actually the first five statements, right? And today inshallah we're going to continue a couple of more statements. But in a nutshell, hopefully everybody realized by now, ya akhwan, that it is wallahi so easy to understand the tawheed, right? And to be frank with you, to summarize everything that we said and what needs to remain or make sure that it, we're conscious about and you know we understand, actually can be explained in a few minutes. That's it. I know that we brought a lot of ayat, a lot of hadith, and we commented a little bit more. But the essence of everything that we said in the last few weeks, right, is that Tawheed is the greatest right of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And this is the first thing that we should start with. And this is the first thing that all the messengers and the prophets of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, this is the first thing that they started with, including Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. For example, when he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu to Yemen at the time, he said, "You are coming to a people of the book, so let the first thing that you tell them that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the only true or the true deity worthy of worship." Right? And once they know that, then tell them that Allah Azza wa Jal mandated five daily prayers on them and mandatory zakah, or the mandatory sadaqah, which is a zakah, right? Etc., etc., to the rest of the art, to the pillars of Islam, right? So this is the first thing. And the first thing that all the messengers said to their people, right? اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره. Worship Allah, for you have no deity other than Allah Azza wa Jal worthy of worship, right? And we said this tawheed is actually of three aspects. And we said that this is actually can be understood from the Quran. We said the first aspect is tawheed al-rububiyyah, which is tawheed. And we said that tawheed is actually to make something one. What is the meaning of tawheed? Is to make something one. So tawheedullah is to make Allah one. In what aspects? In three aspects. The first one is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. So we said the Tawheed comprises three things. The first one is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, or the Tawheed in Godship, which is to make Allah one with respect to creating and maintaining and managing and providing rizq. Allah Azza wa Jal, what does it mean that Allah is one in His Godship? It means that Allah Azza wa Jal is the only one who creates, is the only one who gives life and takes it or put to death. He is the only one who manages all affairs. What he wants happens. What he wills happens. And what he doesn't will, does not. He is the one who brings the clouds. And he is the one who brings down rain. And he is the one who manages all affairs of everything. This is what it means that Allah Azza wa Jal is one in His Godship, which is what we say in the Arabic language, He is a Rabb. Ar-Rabb, right? Rabbi wa Rabbukum Allah. That's the one. That's one. Second is to say that Allah is one, wahid, in His names and attributes. So the Rabb, the God who created everything and all matters, is in His hands. He is also unique. He is one in His names and attributes. He's got the beautiful names, the Asma al-Husna, and the sublime attributes, al-Sifat al-Ula. And all of what Allah Azza wa Jal told us about Himself in the Quran and in the Sunnah, from names and attributes, Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah, they confirm them. They believe in them. They understand their meaning. But they say, we don't know the realities. And we say that nobody and nothing resembles Allah Azza wa Jal in these names and attributes. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Nobody is like unto him. So even if the name of the attribute or the term that we refer to the attribute is the same as in the servants, that doesn't mean the reality of that attribute is the same. Hence Allah Azza wa Jal continued the ayah and he said, وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. And he is the all-hearing, the all-seeing. And we hear and we see, right? I hear and you hear, and I see and you see. So does it mean that the same seeing and hearing, the same attribute is the same that that of Allah Azza wa Jal? We say no. The fact it has the same name doesn't mean that the reality of it, all of the names and all the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal are great like himself, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, and they are according to what he is worthy, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, Jalla Jalaluhu. His names and attributes are perfect, free from any defect. Our hearing is limited. But Allah Azza wa Jal hearing is absolute and perfect. Our seeing, I couldn't see behind that wall, could I? But Allah Azza wa Jal can see everything. Can see even in the bottom of our hearts, what's in it, and what we're thinking. Our knowledge is limited. We even sometimes forget something that we knew before. But Allah's knowledge is all-encompassing. It is perfect and absolute. Nothing escapes His knowledge, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. He knows everything, whether it was made in public or whether it is in private. Everything. And nothing escapes His knowledge. So this is what we mean that Allah Azza wa Jal, names and attributes are perfect and they are unique. Nobody resembles Him subhanahu wa ta'ala in these names and attributes. Right? And we say that of every name and every attribute, we confirm it as long as it is in the Quran and in the Sunnah, we confirm it without tamthil. يعني, there are four things, right? بلا تشبيه ولا تعطيل ولا تمثيل ولا تأويل. What is the meaning of all of this? يعني, we say that all the names and attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, we confirm them like He did tabaraka wa ta'ala in the Quran, and like Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did in the Sunnah, right? And Allah Azza wa Jal is more knowledgeable of Himself than anybody else. He knows what His attributes are and He told us about them in the Quran, right? He said, I am al-Basir, I am al-Sami', I am al-Alim, I am al-Aziz, I am al-Qahir, etc., etc., right? Al-Ra'uf, al-Rahman, al-Rahim. All of these are attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, right? But we believe in them, right? Without actually, you know, making them similar to what the servants are, or what the attributes of the servant, yani without actually trying to think what they look like. This is what we call tamthil. And without tashbih, without saying that they are similar, exactly the same attribute of the servant. Without ta'atil, without disabling them, because we said some of the groups, misguided groups, they actually ran away from making Allah looks like the servant, so they disabled His attributes. He said, no, 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 He cannot be hearing, we hear. He cannot be seeing, we see. Right? He cannot be this, because we actually also do the same thing, or are capable of doing the same thing. So they disable these attributes. And we say, no, that doesn't require that they are of the same attribute. And without ta'wil or tahrif, which is to actually give them a meaning different than what the term actually means. So for example, they say in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and he told us, we couldn't know this, right? We have no way, this is from the unseen. We have no way of telling this. But in the hadith sahih, Rasulullah ﷺ told us that Allah Azza wa Jal descends to the lowest sky during the last third of the night, right? To hear who is making istighfar and who is invoking Allah Azza wa Jal. They say, no, 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 that is not worthy of His Majesty, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. So they actually switch the meaning, or they actually explain it as the descent of His mercy. As if His mercy doesn't descend around the clock. It only descends during the last third of the night. How about the rest of the day and night? It doesn't descend. His mercy descends around the clock. It never ceases from descending, His mercy. Otherwise, wallahi, I don't know where we would end up being. His mercy is descending all around the clock, all day and night. It's not restricted to the last third of the night. But this is a, you know, descent, real descent, that is unique to Allah Azza wa Jalla. We don't know how. But we understand that He gets closer to his servants. How? Nobody knows. And we're not to ask how. Nor are we to actually give thoughts as to how. How He hears, how He sees, or how He descends. We don't know. And we have no business in knowing. Because this is beyond what we can imagine. So we believe in these attributes, right? We know the meaning of these attributes. When Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us, I hear, that means that He hears us. He hears everything. And we know what the consequence of that. We'd rather know what to say then. How He hears, we don't know. Only Allah knows. Only Allah knows. And we shouldn't ask about these things. So these are the first two aspects of Tawheed. The third one is, we say that now the Lord, or the God, Rabb, who is unique in being able to create and managing all affairs, and who's unique in having these names and attributes, is the only one who deserves to be worshipped. Which is hence the third type of Tawheed, or category of Tawheed, which is Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, or the Tawheed in Divinity. And sometimes we refer to it as the Tawheed in worship. Right? Because He is the one who deserves. He is the one who creates. Who is the one who gives life? He is the one who gives rizq. He is the one who gives recovery, shifa. وَإِذَا مَرَدْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِي. And those who cannot do any of that, they don't deserve to be worshipped. Who can do all of this? Who created the skies and the earth and all this universe? Allah Azza wa Jalla. Because of that, He deserves and He is worthy of being worshipped. That's why we say Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, or Tawheed al-Ibadah, is to say that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the only true deity who deserves to be worshipped. And that is the meaning of La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Ya'ni there is no true God who is worthy of being worshipped except Allah. And this is the kalimat al-tawheed. And we say that among these three types of tawheed, the core message of the messengers was the third one, which is tawheed al-uluhiyya. We said why? Because none of the mushrikeen, even mushrikeen Quraysh, who used to worship the idols that Rasulullah ﷺ was sent to, they did not dispute the first two tawheed. Tawheed al-Rububiyya. They believed that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the only one who created this whole universe. They didn't dispute that fact. As a matter of fact, Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran, like we saw, in many instances, He told us that they actually confirmed that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the only creator. وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. And if you ask them, يعني O Muhammad, if you ask them, مشركي قريش, who created the skies and the earth, they would surely say Allah. They admit to that. They didn't dispute in Allah being a Rabb, the one Khaliq, the one Raziq, the one Muhyi and Mumit. They didn't dispute that. They also didn't dispute that He has the beautiful names and the sublime attributes. They believed He could hear and He could see and all of that. Which Tawheed did they actually make a mistake in? Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, because they offered some of their acts of worship to the idols, claiming that they bring them closer to Allah Azza wa Jalla. And this is the shirk that was in Mushriki Quraysh that the Prophet ﷺ was sent to fix. So we say Tawheed is three types, three categories, but the one that we are required to, or the goal of the message, is the third one, because this is where the problem was. Now some people say, no, wait a minute, where did he get all of this from, right? Tawheed is only Tawheed al-Rububiyya, to believe Allah Azza wa Jalla is the only creator, and that should be sufficient. You're muwahhid. We say, but the mushrikeen Quraysh, admitted to that, and yet Allah Azza wa Jal sent books down, sent the Quran down, and sent Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as a messenger, and he even fought them. So if they were muwahhid, why did he fight them? And what was the need to send the messenger then? There must be a problem then that needed to be fixed. And this is the shirk in tawheed al-uluhiyyah. And remember, just a quick, to give you a quick reminder as well, I told you about the story of the grandfather of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdul Muttalib, right? During the year where Abraha came to demolish al-Bayt al-Haram, Kaaba, right? And they were, he brought a huge army that Quraysh, the residents of Mecca, were no match to. So they knew they couldn't actually fight back. So what did he tell them? He told them, you know, Mecca is surrounded by mountains, right? From all different directions. He said, run to the mountain top for your life. You're no match. There's no point in fighting back. We're not going to be able to. We'll be killed all. Run for your life. Take all your property and run to the mountain tops for your life. So they told them, Abdul Muttalib, and who's going to defend? What about the Bayt al-Atiq? The old house, which is in Kaaba. You know what he said? What did Abdul Muttalib say? And he is a mushrik. What did he say? He said, "Lil bayti rabbun yahmihi." He said, for this house, there is a God who will protect it. So they believe that that Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who brings benefit and ward off harm and protect and preserve. Yet Allah Azza wa Jal called them mushrikeen. That is because they actually committed shirk in tawheed al-uluhiyyah. By Allah, is that difficult to understand? Is that overly complex to understand? What's complex in all of this? Wallahi, I can tell you, a kid, one of these kids who just heard me, will be able to repeat what I said. It's wallahi so simple. And it confirms to the very nature of the humankind that Allah Azza wa Jal created them with. We by nature look to Allah Azza wa Jal. We actually understand that Allah Azza wa Jal is the creator and the only one who deserves to be worshipped by our very nature, pure nature. So it's not complex. A lot of people make people feel shy away from al-Aqeedah or understanding the Aqeedah, saying that this is, you know, Aqeedah is too dry, overly complex, not necessary. Don't worry about it, don't waste your time. That's terribly wrong. Like we said, ya akhwan, and this is the Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala who said this, as confirmed by Imam Abu Jaafar al-Tahawi. He used to call al-Aqeedah usul al-deen, the principle, the very root of the deen. And he used to call it al-fiqh al-akbar. Al-Aqeedah is al-fiqh al-akbar. And the fiqh, you know the fiqh that we know now, fiqh al-salah, fiqh al-tahara, purity, everything. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah, he used to call it, this is fiqh al-furu', yani the branches of fiqh. But what is the trunk, the root, the principle? Is al-aqeedah, usul al-deen. And like Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi said at the very beginning, that this is a text that describes madhab ahlus sunnati wal jama'ah. So there is no distinction, there is no, absolutely no difference between Imam Abu Hanifa, or Imam Shafi'i, or Imam Ahmad, or Imam Malik with respect to Aqeedah. There is a perfect match among all of them, and this is what they agreed to. And we say this is the madhab, the Aqeedah of madhab al-Imam, this is the Aqeedah of madhab Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. There is no distinction. So nobody should come and tell me, well, I am follower of madhab al-Imam Abu Hanifa. Absolutely, no problem. It should be the same Aqeedah. As a matter of fact, this is a text written by an imam of madhab al-Imam Abu Hanifa. Al-Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi al-Hanafi. And the scholar that who came later on and explained it is Imam Ibn Abi al-Izz al-Hanafi, also from madhab al-Imam Abu Hanifa. And this is what we're relying on in this our explanation. So there is absolutely no distinction. And just let me finish this quick summary of what we discussed before. an easier way to remember, like I told you before. Sometimes we may, you know, over time we may actually forget and mix between the three types of tawheed. What is an easier way to remember them? We say that tawheed al-rububiyyah, which has to do with the Godship, right? We say it is a tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal in His deeds. Easier way to remember. Why? Because we say tawheed al-rububiyyah is the tawheed that Allah is the only creator. So the creation is the deeds of who?
Allah.
Allah. We say He is the only muhyi. He is the only one who provides life. The deed of who? Allah. He is the mumit. He is the one who puts to death and takes away life. This is the deed of who? Allah Azza wa Jal. He is the one who manages the affair. It's His deeds, etc., etc. He is the one who brings water down, rain, etc., etc. So notice that we're talking about whose deeds? Allah's deeds. So Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is Tawheed Allah in His deeds. To say that He is the only one who can do that, all of these. Easy enough? Easy enough. Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, another way of thinking about it, it is Tawheed Allah in our deeds. Because it has to do with worship. We pray to Him. Who is praying? We are the one who is praying. We fast. To who? To Allah. Who is fasting? We are the one who is fasting. We give sadaqah for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. We actually seek assistance, seek tawfiq, seek help in Allah Azza wa Jal alone. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. We only seek assistance from You. Who is seeking assistance? We. So you notice that the Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah has to do with our deeds, being the servants. So we make Tawheed Allah Azza wa Jal in all acts of worship. That is why sometimes it is called Tawheed al-Ibadah. Tawheed of worship. Easy enough? Easy enough. Anyone can understand that. Wallah, it's so easy. That's Tawheed. Khalas, we're done. Alhamdulillah. That's it. If you believe in that, you're a muwahhid. Complete Tawheed to Allah Azza wa Jal. And that is the meaning of La ilaha illallah, which is the first and greatest pillar of Islam. Remember Rasulullah said in the hadith, in the famous hadith, narrated by Ibn Umar radiallahu anhumah. He said Islam was built on five. Famous hadith. The very first one is what? Shahadatu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. That's the first one. Then iqam as-salah, ita' as-zakah, hajj al-bayt, wa sallu Ramadan. But the first and the greatest, and the entry into Islam, into as a deen, entry into Islam is what? أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله. This shahada, what does it mean? لا إله إلا الله. It means that there is no true God, no true deity worthy of worship except Allah. So we notice there is two parts to it. There is a negation and confirmation. We negate any true deity, because there are people around the globe who actually worship other deities, aren't they? There are people who worship cows. There are people who worship mountains, fire, etc. Idols, Buddha, etc. So we say we negate all of them. They're not worthy of being worshipped. They haven't done anything that makes them worthy of being worshipped. And then we confirm that Allah Azza wa Jal is the only true God. The only true ilah, deity. That's the meaning. Full stop. That's it. Easy enough? Easy enough. And that's the meaning of all the statements that we talked about so far. Alhamdulillah. Any questions, ya akhwan? Any questions, comments, concerns before we keep going? Now we said this is the summary of everything that we talked about before. Obviously quickly, right? Very quickly without any evidences or anything. Which we talked about in previous halaqat. Several Saturdays. But if I want to summarize, that's it. This is the summary of Tawheed. Anything complex in it, anything, you know, hard to understand, that's it. This is Tawheed. Questions? Comments? Concerns? No? Okay.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So, Rububiyyah, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, talks about Allah's deeds.
Uluhiyya is adi sifat Allah. What, where does asma wa sifat? When you think about asma wa sifat, it's describing Allah's deeds on us as well. So how do you,
yes,
is it really just two, and then asma is just because of Allah Ta'ala?
That's a very good question. The brother is asking, so we talk about Tawheed al-Rububiyyah has to do with Allah's deeds. We talk about Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah having to do with our deeds, the servant's deeds, right? Then how about Tawheed al-Asma wa-Sifat, which is the Tawheed of the beautiful names and the sublime attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Where do we, or how can we, you know, kind of make it clearer, or you know, say it in another way? The answer to that, Akhi Barakallahu Fik, if you think about it, Tawheed al-Asma wa-Sifat actually is a part of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. The reason Ahlul Sunnati wa Jama'ah actually put it in a separate category and separated it from Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is because there were groups that came afterward, after Rasulullah, who actually misunderstood that and were sent astray. They were misguided with respect to Asma wa Sifat. Like I said, there are groups who came out and who started to actually make Allah resemble His servants. They made them resemble. So they actually made tashbih, me from shabab. Yani they said, Allah hears and we hear, so we're like, you know, we're the same. Another group came and they said, well, wait a minute, no, Allah Azza wa Jalla does not resemble anybody from His creation or anything from His creation. And these attributes have the same name as our attributes. Cannot be. So they disabled them. They said, no, He cannot hear, cannot all of that. And that's also another extreme and wrong. And it opposes the ayah. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. And He is, Allah Azza wa Jalla knows better. Who knows Allah better than Himself? And He is confirming to us in the Quran that I am He all hearing, I am all seeing. And like I said previously, what is so interesting in this ayah is the scholars have said that these two particular attributes, the ability to hear and the ability to see, are the most common attributes among all the creation. And the hearing is even more common than the seeing. That's why we started with it. Yani if you go across the kingdom of animals and the human beings, you'll see one of the most common attributes is the ability to hear. Literally every animal can hear. Right? They may not be able to see, but they can hear. And they rely on that. The next common attribute is seeing. And yet Allah Azza wa Jalla is confirming that He can see and hear. So these disable these attributes. And this is also, they were sent misguided. And there are others who actually took them out of their context and they explained them in a different way than what the meaning of the term is apparently means. You know, so they, for example, they said, hearing is actually knowledge. And the descent is actually the descent of His mercy, etc., etc. Right? So that is why Ahl Sunnati wa Jama'ah, to actually distinguish from these misguided groups and to show what we actually believe in, they made it as a separate category, right? To make it clear of how we believe in His names and attributes, in the names and attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Does that make sense? Otherwise, if you think about it, it is really very similar to Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Because the Rabb also has all those names and attributes. It should have been one category. But just because of the need to set Ahlul Sunnati wa Jama'ah apart from these misguided groups, right, and where they mixed up, so they separated it into a separate category, so that to spell out clearly what we believe in the names and attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Make sense? So what we need to understand is that the goal and the purpose of the message is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Because this is where the problem was. And this is why the messengers fought their people to actually establish Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Any other question?
As-salamu alaykum.
Wa alaykum as-salam.
This is a one word, I just want to clarification about that. It's called a wasila.
Wasila.
A lot of people I mean, you know, I've been hearing a lot about this. It says, without wasila, you cannot reach the God, Allah. So you have to have some kind of wasila with somebody, some like pious person or something. Without that, you cannot be reached by God by himself. I mean,
so the brother is asking a good question. He's saying, you know, some people say that you have to have a wasila, a means, right, to reach Allah Azza wa Jalla. You cannot reach him directly. So you have to go through somebody, pious person, righteous person, etc., you know, wedding, whatever, right, to reach Allah Azza wa Jalla. And I say, by Allah, have you ever read the Quran? Have you ever, not you, but that person who claims that. But I say, by Allah, billah, have you ever read the Quran? What does Allah Azza wa Jalla says in Surah Al-Baqarah, for example? He said, instructing his messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي يعني, O Muhammad, if my servants ask you about me, what should you say? He said, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَى. He didn't say, tell them. Notice, I want to make sure that you actually follow the logic of the ayah, because this actually has, you know, meaning in itself. Notice Allah Azza wa Jalla in that ayah is saying to his Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, if my servants ask you about me, he didn't say tell them. He immediately answered directly to us. He said, I am near, I hear the person who invokes me, the invocation of the person who invokes me. فَإِنِّي قَرِيبْ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَى. I answer the invocation of the person who invokes me. Did Allah guide us to say, to go to a righteous person, go through third party, go, you know, through somebody, because your dua is not acceptable directly. You have to go through somebody. Is this what Allah Azza wa Jalla said?
No.
That's not what he said. He said, I am near you. I am so close to you. Just invoke me and I hear and I will answer your invocation. That's what he's telling us. So where did this come from? Where does it come from that you have to go to a wedding, or you have to go to a righteous person, or you have to go to a pious person and go through him? You don't need to. Allah Azza wa Jalla is closer to you than you think. He's close. Does that answer your question? Any other questions, Ikhwan? No? Okay. Going? Okay. The next statement, which is the sixth statement, so this is where we actually are at, is what Imam Abu Jaafar al-Tahawi al-Hanafi from Misr. Ya Sheikh Shamsuddin. Sheikh Shamsuddin. Sheikh Shamsuddin. Sheikh Abu Jaafar al-Tahawi from Egypt, from Misr. Al-Misri al-Tahawi, muntahaf al-Sa'id. Sa'id Misr. Ayna. MashaAllah, from Misr. Wallahi, Misr is a dear country. You know, that generated a lot of scholars, benefited this ummah. Wallahi, a lot of scholars. Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi from Taha, from Sa'id Misr, is one of them. And this is, he is the author of this book, Al-Aqeedah al-Tahawiyya, that we're trying to explain. He said, next, after he said, and nothing besides him has the right to be worshipped, وَلَا إِلَهَ غَيْرٌ, then he said, قَدِيمٌ بِلَا ابْتِدَاءٌ دَائِمٌ بِلَا انْتِهَاءٌ. The English translation of this is ancient without any beginning, remaining forever without any end. Now, I'm going to say that the next few statements, this is the first one of which, are all description or attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla. You're going to see that there are all attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla. But they are not in a specific order. And there is nothing wrong in that. Yani Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he didn't actually follow any specific order. So sometimes you may see that he talks about something, then he shifts to something else, then he says another statement to complete the meaning that is so close to a much previous statement, right? So he's not following any particular order. Otherwise, it would have been probably better if you just say all the statements that are kind of related, you know, one after the other, and then you move to another topic. But this is, you know, I just wanted to let you know that this is what he is actually doing in here. So he said, قَدِيمٌ بِلَا ابْتِدَاءٍ, ancient without beginning, and دَائِمٌ بِلَا انْتِهَاءٍ, remaining forever without any end. What he wanted to say, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, in this statement, is that he wanted to actually make تَنْزِيه of Allah Azza wa Jal above his creation. يعني, he is making Allah Azza wa Jal above anything that he created, and he's saying that Allah Azza wa Jal is free from any creation. Because we know that from the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal is the time. The time that we conceive is actually something that is created. It didn't exist since ever. And it's not gonna last forever. The time that we use, and the time frames that every creation enjoys, you know, for example, the umr, our time frame that we spent in this life, right? This is also according to the time. The time is one of the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, right? So he's making Allah Azza wa Jal above the time. Yani that he's saying that the time is actually one of the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah is not bound by this time. And likewise, Allah Azza wa Jal created the places, and he is not bound by those places. Allah Azza wa Jal is actually above that. So in here, he is saying that Allah Azza wa Jal actually is before time. So there was no point in time where before it, Allah did not exist, and after that, he existed, subhanahu wa ta'ala, ta'ala Allah. Nor is there a time, or will there be time, right, when he will exist, but after which he won't exist. He's saying that the time does not apply to Allah Azza wa Jal, and the time in Allah Azza wa Jal is not bound by the time, or by the place for that matter. So Allah Azza wa Jal has been there since ever, and will be there forever, right? He is not bound by any particular time. Now, we see that in the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions a lot of ayat in that meaning, with a similar meaning. For example, Allah Azza wa Jal says in the ayah of Surah Al-Hadid, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم, which literally means he is the first and the last. الأول والآخر, he is the first and the last, the ascendant and the intimate, and he is of all things knowing. In another hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is a rather long hadith. This hadith is in Sahih Muslim, Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala, from hadith Suhayl ibn Sa'd radiyallahu anhu, where it tells us about a dua that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa taught to his companions to say before going to sleep. So when they go to bed, right, he guided them to put or to sleep on their right side and to say this dua. From that dua, right, it's like I said, it's a long hadith. From that dua, he alayhi salatu wasalam said, أنت الأول فليس قبلك شيء وأنت الآخر فليس بعدك شيء. يعني, O Allah, you are the first, so there is none before you. And you are the last, so there is none after you. الأول والآخر. So there is no time before Allah Azza wa Jal, and there is no time after Allah Azza wa Jal, right? There's no time before which there was no Allah, so the time came before Allah. Or there's no time after Allah, meaning that after that time Allah will not exist. There's no such thing. He is the first, and he is the last. And there is also no creation who preceded Allah Azza wa Jalla, came before Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there will be no creation that comes after Allah Azza wa Jalla. Likewise, there is no place before Him, and there is no place after Him. Right? Again, He is the first, and He is the last. Now notice that Imam Abu Jaafar, in his Aqeedah, in this text, he used the words Qadim, right, and Da'im, ancient and remaining. But we see in the Quran and in the Sunnah, none of these terms are used. What is used is Al-Awwal wal-Akhir. We say that these terms are better than the terms that Imam Abu Jaafar al-Tahawi used, and it would have been better if he used the Awwal wal-Akhir, like Allah Azza wa Jalla described Himself, and like Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi described Allah Azza wa Jalla. Why? Because obviously we say that whatever terms Allah Azza wa Jalla used will be more accurate and will describe Him subhanahu wa ta'ala in a more perfect and in a more complete way. Right? And if we come up with other terms, right, there may be some defect in them. You know, if you look at them from one aspect, there may be a defect in them that you may not foresee. And actually, Imam Abu Jaafar, actually, it seems like he foresee some issue with that. Because here's Yahwan, when you say Qadim. Qadim, literal translation, is old. Right? You say this car is old. Sayyara Qadima. Right? Or this tree is old. يعني هذه شجرة قديمة. قديمة is to describe, right, that relative to other things, this happened before. يعني usually when you use the term old, it is relative to other things, which means that something came afterward, and that's that thing that came afterward, you would call it new. And the previous one, you would call it what? Old, right? So for example, you know, tax forms, tax return is about to start. Once in a while, they change these forms. So the IRS may say, you're not allowed to use anymore the old forms. There's the new form that you should use. The old forms are not allowed anymore, will not be accepted. Why? Why are they called old? Because there is a newer version of it, right? So with respect to the new one, this is old now. But it doesn't say anything about the fact that it can be preceded by something else. The fact that you describe it as old does not necessarily mean that there is nothing that came even before it, does it? There's no guarantee. So you can say this is old with respect or relative to something new, but there also could be something older than it. There's nothing that prevents that possibility. That is why al-awwal, first, is better. And which is what Allah Azza wa Jalla used. He said, I am the first, I am al-awwal. When you say al-awwal, there is no way something could have happened before. He preceded everything because he's al-awwal, first. And Imam Abu Jaafar noticed this, right? So that is why he actually quantified it. He didn't just say qadim, he said qadim bila ibtida'. يعني ancient without beginning, to quantify it and make the meaning correct. Because if he said qadim is and that's it, that would have been a wrong meaning. So he said old, but to make sure that it is correct, he quantified it and he said but without any beginning. يعني the oldest or the first, الأول. Likewise, he said دائم بلا انتهاء. Yani remaining. Again, if you say remaining, it is conceivable that something could come afterward as well. Nothing prevents from that. That is why he quantified it and he said without any end. But again, like I said, if he used al-akhir, that would have been a better term that describes exactly Allah Azza wa Jal. He is the last. So he is the first, nothing before him, and he is the last, nothing after him. Like Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, أنت الأول فليس قبلك شيء. Oh Allah, you are the first, and there is none before you. And you are الآخر. What does it mean? فليس بعدك شيء. So there is nothing after you. And this is a description that Allah Azza wa Jal preceded everything and will be there forever. Nothing will come after him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the, inshallah, this will be the last discussion related to this. The reason I'm spending a little bit of time on this and explaining that this is different than the terms that are used in the Quran and in the Sunnah is, one might come and say, طيب, Imam Abu Ja'far used the term qadim, old. Can we understand from that this is one of the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal? Yani, can we describe Allah Azza wa Jal as qadim? You know, we say Allah is qadim. Or does it also, can we derive from that one of his names is Al-Qadim? And can I address Allah Azza wa Jal by saying, O Al-Qadim? We say no. That's why I'm spending a little bit of time. Because although he is using it as a description, as an attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal, but he is actually telling, he is using it as a way of telling, ikhbar, anillah. Ikhbar, he's telling us about Allah Azza wa Jal, that he has no beginning, he's all with no beginning. But that doesn't mean that we can actually describe or attribute to Allah Azza wa Jal, right? The attribute, sifa, as qadim. Like we say, Allah sami', Allah basir, right? And that is why we can actually call upon Allah Azza wa Jal by saying As-Sami' Al-Basir. I can call upon Allah Azza wa Jal by addressing my dua or my invocation to As-Sami'. That's one of the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. Can I actually address Allah Azza wa Jal by saying Al-Qadim? O Al-Qadim? Say no. It is not permissible, and this is not something to be understood. Not something to be understood from here. The reason being, ya akhwan, this is for actually multiple reasons. One of them is that we say that the rule with respect to the names and attributes for Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah is that we should only attribute to Allah Azza wa Jal what has been mentioned to us in the Quran, in either the Quran or the Sunnah. Yani, with respect to al-asma' wa-sifat, we cannot create or come up with new names or new attributes and attribute them to Allah Azza wa Jalla. We call them al-asma' wa-sifat tawqifiyah. Yani, we stop at only what Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us. The reason being, ya akhwan, is nobody has seen Allah Azza wa Jalla. Nobody knows Allah Azza wa Jal as he knows himself. So how can we attribute to him an attribute or a sifa or a name without seeing him or without knowing him really in reality, right? So madhab Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah is to actually only limit the names and the attributes to what Allah Azza wa Jal told us or his messenger alayhi salatu wassalam told us in Sahih al-Sunnah, and to only restrict to that. That's the first one, that's the first reason. The second is, like I said, because we cannot invoke Allah Azza wa Jal by this name, Al-Qadim. So like I said, you cannot say, for example, Oh Al-Qadim, or Ya Qadim, give me. Now, for example, we know Al-Ghani is one of the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. So Akhuna Mujtaba Barakallahu Fi can make a dua to Allah Azza wa Jal by saying, Ya Ghani Aghnini. O self-sufficient, give me from your bounties. Can you say that? Yes, you can. You can say that. Why? Because Al-Ghani is one of his names. And Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. To Allah belong all the best names, so invoke him by them. So the names are to be used. Right? You say, Ya Rahman Irhamni. O merciful, have mercy upon me. Ya Ghaffar Ighfirni. O forgiving, forgive me. Right? So the names are to be used. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. طيب, القديم, can I actually call upon Allah Azza wa Jal by using that name, القديم? No. I cannot say, يَا قَدِيم أَعْطِنِي, or يَا أَيُّهَا الْقَدِيم, or يَا Allah, oh my Lord, I ask you by being القديم to give me. That's wrong. So the fact that he used قَدِيم بِلَا انْتِهَاء doesn't mean that this is one of his names or one of his attributes. Like I said, because we restrict that to what Allah Azza wa Jal told us in the Quran and in the Sunnah. And this is not something that I can call upon Allah Azza wa Jal or invoke Him, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, by this. So it's not a name, nor is it an attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal. And the names, like I said, are to be used to invoke Allah Azza wa Jal, to call upon Allah Azza wa Jal. Speaking of those names and attributes, right? And this is the last thing, inshallah, and we'll stop and then we'll take a break. Is what are the conditions or what are the things that limit or kind of define what can be a name or attribute and what cannot be? We say for Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, there are three things to know about. The first one is that that name or attribute appeared in an ayah or a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yani it is something that was conveyed to us, it is something that was taught to us by Allah Azza wa Jal or His Messenger alayhi salatu wassalam, in either the Quran or the Sunnah. We cannot bring a name or an attribute of our own and start calling upon Allah Azza wa Jal by it. Whatever Allah Azza wa Jal told us about, and the Quran is rich in names and attributes, likewise the Sunnah is rich in names and attributes, we are to only use them. Because this is from the unseen, and we say this is tawqif. Yani we stop at only limit to what Allah Azza wa Jal and His Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam told us. The second one is to say that it has a name, has to be something that you can call upon Allah Azza wa Jal by using. That's why it's called a name, right? Yani when you call somebody, to Allah belong the greatest example. But just to make it clearer, right? Why do we call ourselves names? So then I can call you and you can call me, right? I mean, alhamdulillah, mashallah, here we have like what, 20 people here? If I want to talk to Brother Yusuf and I say, hey, everybody may answer. How does he know, a person know that I'm actually talking to him? But if I say, yeah, Yusuf, oh, okay, he knows that I'm talking to him now, right? Not to his son who's sitting right behind him. So the names, to call upon a person, likewise, Allah Azza wa Jal has names. Al-Aziz, Ya Aziz, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Irhamni. So they are to be used to call upon Allah Azza wa Jal. So the second thing that must be there, or condition, is that that term is something that I can use to call upon Allah Azza wa Jal. And we've seen that I cannot use Qadim. I cannot say Ya Qadim. Give me. Right? It's not a name that can be used to call upon Allah Azza wa Jal. So third is that it has to be, that term, that name, has to be describing of Allah Azza wa Jal in a perfect, complete manner. You notice that all the names and all the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, they all have perfect meanings. So we say Al-Aziz because he is not in need of anybody else. Self-sufficient. Al-Ghani also is self-sufficient. Aziz, nobody can actually humiliate him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ta'ala Allah ma'amma yaqul. Rahman, perfect Rahman. Yani you can have somebody who is Rahim, you know, compassionate with others, but that compassion is not a full compassion. It's, you know, a يعني, limited compassion that, which is يعني, what a human being can, how compassionate a human being can possibly can. But Allah Azza wa Jal, compassion is a full, perfect compassion. Mercy, likewise. You can be merciful with your kids, you can be merciful with your wife, but that mercy is limited. Allah's mercy is perfect and complete. And the same thing applies to all the names and attributes. So any name that cannot be or is not a complete and perfect attribute to Allah Azza wa Jalla may have a defect, right? Or incompleteness in it, doesn't work as a name. And we said al-Qadim alone, like I said, is incomplete, is imperfect, because it can be understood that something preceded it. And that's why Imam Abu Jaafar, rahimahullah, he needed to actually add to it and say, without any beginning. He didn't say just ancient, with, and that's it. He said ancient without any beginning, because ancient alone is not perfect and can be a defective or you know, an attribute that can have a defect or be incomplete. But compare that to al-awwal. Al-awwal is perfect from every aspect. Al-akhir is perfect from every aspect. And that is why Allah Azza wa Jalla used that, those terms. He said, أنا الأول والآخر. هو الأول والآخر. You know, describing himself subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the three things. It has to be from the Quran and the Sunnah, right? It has to be complete and perfect meaning. There's no imperfection in it. And the third, it has to be something that you can use to call upon Allah Azza wa Jalla and invoke Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the three conditions that have to be in the term to be as a name or attribute to Allah Azza wa Jalla. I see that you have a question.
Just a quick one.
Yes.
Regarding the perfection of the name of Allah, it's Alif and Lam. The Alif and Lam that precedes the name. Does that make the name perfect? Because I'm saying, my son here is Abdul Hakim.
Yeah.
A lot of people call him Hakim.
Yes.
Right. So just wanted to know whether the Alif and Lam makes the difference.
Al is Al al-Ta'rif in the Arabic language. We call it Alif Alif Lam al-Ta'rif, which means that it actually tells you about something in particular. Yeah. Hakim as a term means wise, right? It comes from al-Hikmah, wisdom. If you say a person is Hakim, or you know, a Hakim came, that could be any person, or could be any person who has wisdom. But when you say Al-Hakim, you are actually referring to a particular one. Like you say, for example, a man, the man. You say a man, a man came. That could refer to any man. Right? Yeah, somebody, I may not even know who he is, right? A man, king. But when you say the man, it's usually something that you and the one you're talking to, right? You both know who that person is. So you're referring to a particular person, right? And this is the same thing. You say al-Hakim, so you cannot call a particular person al-Hakim, al-Aziz. No, this is only Allah Azza wa Jalla. Because Allah is Al-Aziz, Al-Hakim, Al-Rahim, Al-Wadud, Al-Ghafur, Al-Qawi, right? Al-Ali, Al-Ali. You say somebody Ali, meaning that he has some knowledge. Again, it's not a perfect knowledge. But when you say Al-Ali, it is Allah Azza wa Jalla. Now, speaking of that, some people actually shortcut them, you know, they use the second term, you know, Abdul Aziz becomes Aziz. Abdul Mannan becomes Mannan. Abdul Alim becomes Alim. To be frank with you, that's wrong. I don't like it. Because, you know, the full name, you know, you actually, hopefully, you name your son or, you know, that a particular person is named as Abdul Aziz, Abdul Mannan, Abdul Wadud, Abdul Rahman. That's a great meaning. And it comprises of a great meaning, and it reminds you that you are a servant to Al-Aziz, Al-Rahim, Al-Mannan, right? And some of it, by the way, you know, obviously because of the lack of the knowledge of the Arabic language and the true meaning of the word itself, right? It could actually backfire, because I can tell you, Al-Mannan is the one who actually holds favor to you, yani Allah Azza wa Jalla is Al-Mannan, and He deserves that because He yamun alayna, yani He holds favor upon us that I am the one who gave you everything. Whatever bounty that you have is from me. If that person is now called Mannan, Yani he is actually making people, hey, you know, I gave you something, which is not a very good meaning, by the way, right? So, as a general rule, you know, really, the original name should be the one that is used, you know, even if you're in the West, right? I'm pretty sure everybody knows is familiar with those names. Abdullah, Abdurrahman, that's a common name by now. Everybody, even the Americans, right? They all know these names, Abdul Salam. They all know these names. Abdullah is actually pretty popular, and Abdurrahman. They know that, so there's no point. I don't understand why we do this, to be frank with you, right? Why do we do that? It's actually a beautiful name. Wallahi, it's an honor for the servant to be a servant of Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's the greatest honor of the servant, to actually serve his Lord, who created him and who bestows upon him, and whose every bounty that you have, you can count or can't count, is from him. So you being servant of Allah Azza wa Jalla is a great honor. So I don't know why I can do this, to be frank with you. I make it a point to be frank with you. My son, my other younger male son, or son, is actually Abdul Aziz. Make sure everybody, whenever we go to school or everything, because some, they try to shortcut it. We say, no, his name is Abdul Aziz. That's his name, don't take part of it, or nickname and whatever, you know. And one last thought, real quick, sorry, let's take a break. But to be frank with you, in some instances, because people separate between the two terms, make them like as if it's two words, and because, subhanAllah, some of the kids don't know the meaning of it, it becomes sometimes ridiculous. I'm pretty sure you all heard of this. Have you heard of some people called Abdul? They become Abdul. Yeah, his name is Abdul Rahman. And now, you know, they're trying to make it shorter, right? So he's also known as Abdul. Yeah, it has no meaning. What is Abdul? That's not a word. As a matter of fact, this ul at the end is not part of the abd, it's part of Rahman. And when you join the two words, you become Abdul Aziz. Just there was a way of pronunciation. But if you want to separate them, it is of two words, Abd and Al Aziz. Abd Al Rahman, Abd Al Salam. But to pronounce it in the Arabic language, when you actually make it a compound name, it becomes Abdul Samad, Abdul Aziz. Now they take Abdul. It has no meaning. To be frank with you, it's ridiculous. It becomes ridiculous, and you know, and he becomes known as this Abdul. What do you mean by Abdul? You know what I'm saying? Subhanallah. Khair. Wafikum barakallah. Any questions? We'll take a break and then we'll continue to the next one, which is, he does not perish nor pass away. Oh, he's going to be here at 6:20? Oh, subhanAllah. Do we have something else? Because I know, I can tell by the faces, people are getting tired. So, okay, no problem, inshallah. Let's take a break. We'll start with something else because the pizza is on its way. But let's take a break, inshallah, and then we'll come back.